now it is my great pleasure to introduce the next speaker to you. This is Hans Clevers. Hans Clevers is a professor of molecular genetics at Utrecht University and at the Utrecht Medical Center, Utrecht. He is a principal investigator at the Habrecht Institute and the Princess Maxima Center for Pediatric Oncology and Oncode Investigator. He used to be the president of the Royal Netherlands Academy of Arts and Sciences from 2012 till 2015. Hans Clevers became famous with his stem cell research into health and sick intestine. He discovered in 1997 how a derailment of the normal cell production in the inner coating of the intestine results in the formation of polyps. Building on this, his research group identified the intestinal stem cell and developed methods to grow these stem cells in a laboratory into mini intestines, organoids. Hans Clevers has been awarded numerous prizes for his research, including the Spinoza Prize, the highest academic distinction in the Netherlands, and the Heineken Prize for Medicine in 2012. And in 2013, he was awarded the 3 million breakthrough in life sciences. Hans, we are very proud to have you here in our conference and that you are willing to share with us your research data. I would like to ask you to share your screen, if you can manage this.
I think I can.
And the stage is yours now.
Hold on, I have to. Well, thanks very much, Peter, for a kind introduction and for, hold on, see if this works, for allowing me to present some of our more recent data. So what I'll try to do in the next 30 minutes or so is give you a little bit of background as to how we developed organoid technology based on cells in the organ that you see here. And then I'll give you three recent examples of various applications of this technology in our lab. So what you see here is the interior of the intestine. These structures are called villi, surface extensions that help to digest food efficiently and take up the nutrients efficiently. This epithelium is constantly being self-renewed by stem cells that have been elusive for a long time. They were assumed to be at the base of the crypt. We discovered them. I won't give you the details as to how we proved that they're the stem cells, but LGR5 we found as a novel marker for stem cells. In a knock-in mouse, you can see that GFP, you can nicely see that the cells express GFP. They're tiny. Many pathologists even now don't see them. They sit in between the Paneth cells of the crypt. And once we had these mice, and then later on we found the same cells in humans, we realized that a lot of the ideas that people had about stem cells turn out to be wrong, at least for this stem cell type, and we now believe that that's probably true for most stem cell types. For instance, these stem cells are not rare, they're very abundant, but most importantly for my story today is that these stem cells constantly divide, whereas most stem cell biologists believe that stem cells are quiescent, typically that they very, very rarely divide. Now, when we notice that they divide every day in a mouse, every 2 days in a human being, so they go through literally thousands of consecutive cell divisions in the lifetime of a mouse or a human, we decided to see if we could grow them. And the intention originally was to grow them into a lump of stem cells, starting from one stem cell, done by Toshi Sato. We only need three recombinant proteins. Our spawnin is a Wnt activator. Earlier, we had shown that Wnt is a key growth factor for stem cells in many different tissues, originally in the gut. We need EGF and we need a BMP inhibitor. We do this in Matrigel, so in 3D. There is no serum, so it's with the exception of Matrigel, this is a fully defined medium. Much to our surprise, we see these structures developing. You can see them here in growing over 3 or 4 days. Extremely vital. They grow for many, many years. When we sequence them, we never see oncogenic mutations. When we transplant them back after they've been grown from a single cell into 100 million cells, they make normal tissue. And so based on this and on the fact that we see all the cell types of the gut and the structure of the gut, reflected in these organoids, in these structures. We term these things gut organoids. We grow them from adult stem cells. They're very important. There's another approach where you grow organoids from iPS cells. That's not done in my lab. That's done many other labs. And we've since developed many, many different protocols, always variations on the same theme of growth factors for, as you can see here, a long list of tissues. And typically, one can take a tiny bit of tissue, a biopsy from any piece of the human body, stick it in the correct cocktail of growth factors. It'll start growing. It'll only reflect the epithelial elements of the tissue. But for internal organs, these are the majority of the functions are actually in the epithelium. And then you can do nice experiments, but you can also model cancer. You can model hereditary disease straight out of patients. And you can model infectious disease. And I'll give some examples for the latter two. So this is actually what I now show is not very recent. This was done in 2012, 2013, 1 or 2 years after we first developed this technology. a group in Utrecht, Cors van der Ent and Jeffrey Beekman, came to me and asked if we could make mini colons from patients, kids with cystic fibrosis. Essentially, it involves a small rectal biopsy, painless. And the idea was that we could actually grow these organoids and then develop them into a functional test for the CFTR channel. That's the gene that is mutant, invariably mutant in CF patients. But as you can see here, there's a wide variety of different mutations. There's a common mutation, Delta 508. About half of the patients worldwide are homozygous for Delta 508. But then you see there's a whole slew of other mutations that probably have different effects on the protein. You see that again, so half of the patients are the homozygous for Delta 508. A drug was developed, a spectacular drug called Orkambi. I'll say something about it in the next slide. But this was specifically developed for this mutation and would in principle not work for these other mutations. And some of these mutations are exceedingly rare. They can only exist in one family or in a small ethnic group or in one village. And in essence, it would be impossible to develop drugs or even to do trials to see if Orkambi, that you see here, would work for any of these patients. Now, to remind you what the disease is, here you see the airway epithelium, but the same holds for many other epithelia in the internal organs. The Delta 508 patients make a mutant protein that misfolds and as a consequence is degraded. The chloride channel, which is the CFTR channel, is then doesn't reach the surface of the cell. Sodium ions go in, but chloride ions cannot go out. And as a consequence, the mucus dries out, becomes very viscous, infections occur, and eventually inflammation, chronic inflammation and fibrosis, and then the internal organ like the lung will be defective. Now, Orkambi consists of two components. One helps the folding, you just saw that. The other helps the gating of the chloride channel, and the combination of these two compounds miraculously can correct for the Delta 508 mutation. Now, what we did with Cors van der Ent and Jeffrey Beekman, we grew rectal organoids from healthy patients. If we open the CFTR channel with cholera toxin, that's cholera is a toxin because it opens the CFTR channel in the gut of patients. They dehydrate, they make a massive diarrhea and they die. That's what you see here. When we open the channel with cholera toxin, water will enter the lumen. They rapidly swell. This movie runs over 1 hour. And this is essentially a functional test for the CFTR chloride channel. Now, if we now go to an organoid from a patient, we in our biobank have about 700 patients, half the Dutch population. First of all, you can see that they grow well, but there is hardly a lumen compared to here in these organoids. And then when we add cholera toxin, nothing happens. This is the reason why these patients have CF. They have no functional CFTR channel. It's also the reason why the CF mutations are so common, because these patients, and particularly carriers, are protected against the effect of cholera toxin. So in medieval times, epidemics of the cholera bacterium would not touch CF carriers as much as they would touch healthy controls. Now, if you take these organoids, we pre-expose them to Orkambi, and we then add the cholera toxin, we completely restore the swelling assay. You can compare the middle and the right here. So this turns out to be a black and white test. We've now done hundreds for these and predicts 100% whether a patient will or will not respond to a drug independent of the mutation that the patient carries. Fabian is a little hero here. He appears here in the most popular Dutch talk show. His story is that he has a mutation that's exceedingly rare. Only him and his aunt are known to carry this mutation. Not eligible for a combi treatment, the only real treatment for CF patients. He was the reason that we actually started collaborating with the pediatrics hospital, set up this assay. His organoids responded fantastically well in the functional assay. Based on this, he was then given the drug, extremely expensive. The hospital paid for this. He responded very well. Here he tells his story. He's actually back on the sports fields at the moment. And now based on him and multiple other patients, the registration of the drug Orkambi in Holland now says it can be given for the Delta 5 weight patients, so 50% of the patients, but it can also be given and reimbursed to patients in that other 50% with unusual mutations if their organoid test is positive. So I think it's the first time that organoids are used in personalized medicine. We've also, right after CRISPR was published, my movie doesn't run, we tried to repair, this is 2013 that we published this, we probably were the first to you probably know how CRISPR works anyway, we were probably the first to repair a human genetic mutation in stem cells of humans. Here you see one patient where we went through the homologous recombination and we repaired the mutations. This is before and this is after we did this. So these cells are identical to these. The only exception is that they no longer carry the Delta 5 rate mutation that this patient was carrying. More recently, we have actually done the same thing, published this year with base editors, which work spectacularly well. We see no off-target mutations, which with the classical Cas9 can be a problem. And we get an extremely high efficiency of correction of mutations, particularly of stop codons, for which Orkambi, the drug would never work because the Orkambi needs to work on a protein. And when there is no protein, it cannot do its work. Then a second story, a little complex. I have to explain you a little bit. What we try to investigate is a particular strain of E. coli that probably 20% of humans carry in their colon. It's called PKS E. coli, and it's presumed to produce a small molecule called colibactin, which had been seen to cause double-strand breaks in DNA. Before I tell the story, I have to explain you a little bit about the system that we are going to use. It was set up by the director of the Sanger Center, our collaborator Mike Stratton, about 6 years ago. And what he did is he tried to classify somatic mutations that occur, for instance, in cancer, by not only looking at the six different single base changes that one can see, but also by including the base directly upstream and directly downstream that single base change. And this leads in total to 96 different, you might call them triplets. Now, if you sequence a cancer and you sequence the blood DNA of a patient, you can determine where the mutations are, but you can also determine what kinds of mutations according to this system occur in cancers. And here you see the 96 triplets that represent all of the single base changes, including their direct upstream and downstream bases. So these are C's to A's with all the flanking bases, C's to G's. If you sequence cancers of smokers, what you'll see is that the overwhelming majority of single base changes are C to A changes and nothing much occurs elsewhere. And the flanking bases have some effect but are not absolute. These two here are very common, but you can see that for all of these C2As, independent of the flanking bases, with maybe the exception of this one, you can see that they occur. If you do the same thing for melanomas, and not induced by tobacco carcinogens, but by UV exposure, nothing happens in the C2A area, but you see C2Ts, and particularly these particular C2Ts, where upstream there is a T and downstream there's an A or a C, a G or a T. That's what we also wanted to do for this E. coli. Here you see the extra piece of DNA that PKS E. coli carry relative to a wild-type E. coli strain. It's about 60 kilobases. It encodes about 10 genes, and these genes together constitute a synthetic pathway for a polyketide that long had been very elusive, but it had already been named colibactin. If you culture PKS E. coli on a cell line, what you'll see in a matter of hours, that double strand breaks in that cell line starts accumulating, and therefore it was assumed that somehow colibactin, although the structure wasn't known then, is actually a mutagen or somehow damages DNA. Now, while we were doing the study, a chemical study appeared in Science. There actually was another paper in Science in the same year that came up with a very different structure, but we believe that this is the structure of colibactin. And in that paper, they showed that the two warheads can covalently bind to A residues in DNA, for instance, like this. So binding on one A on one strand and another A on the other strand, causing a double strand, an interstrand link. A cell cannot live with this. It either dies or it has to remove this. And in that process, we assumed possibly mutations would occur, and this would then contribute to colon cancer. And I should stress that PKS E. coli in multiple papers has been seen to be associated with colon cancer, but also with other diseases of the colon. To summarize what we're going to do in a movie, so here again you see the individual enterocytes of the small intestine or the colon. This is the E. coli, the wild type E. coli. This is E. coli that has these extra 60 kilobases with the 10 genes that allow it to make colibactin. You see it here. It is secreted. It's believed probably to be used by the bacterium to kill other bacteria in a competitive fashion, but the host cells might be innocent bystanders that get hit. We have the PKS E. coli. We also have a mutant strain that lacks one of the 10 extra genes. You can culture them just on agar, make enough of them. We pick them up in a pipette. We inject them into healthy human colon organoids. You see it happening here. We let them live inside for about a week. They will slowly overgrow the culture if we let that continuously go on. So we then treat with antibiotics, clean the organoids, passage them. And then the next week, we again inject them with E. coli or with the mutant one and treat with antibiotics again. So we do this for about 3 to 4 months. Thus, we mimic chronic exposure to this bacterium and to its colibactin. This would be the one that got hit. This is the negative control. After a number of months, we take single cells, we grow them up as organoids again, so they're clonal, we sequence them, and the sequences we get out inform us about the exact DNA changes that were present in the single cells that give rise to these clones after having been exposed to the PKS E. coli or to the negative control. And what we noticed indeed, I won't have to finish this movie, this is again the layout, so we have a clonal organoid. So if we sequence this one, it is homogeneous, we get a single genomic sequence. We grow them for 5 months in the chronic exposure of the bacterium or in the mutant control here. We subclone single cells after 5 months and we sequence them. Here you see E. coli in the organoid. And then we perform the Stratton signature classification and we indeed get a unique signature. So again, I remind you of the smokers would have a signature here. The UV radiated melanomas would have a signature here, but we get these unique, very specific peaks of T to Cs, or on the other strand, A's to G's. And in fact, what we see is that the T or the A on the other strand can be changed into any other base. If you just look at the flanking two bases, they are A's and T's. But if you now look in a wider context, we see at -3, there is an A. At 0, there is a T, so there is an A on the negative strand. And so this would be our model, what E. coli colibactin does. It gets secreted, enters the host cell, covalently binds to one A at -3, covalently binds to the other A at 0, at position 0, and the interstrand crosslink needs to be resolved by the cell. And in that process, it causes mutations. It changes the T into any other base, or it essentially, I don't show this here, it'll delete the T. That's also what we see a lot. Now, this is all done in a lab. When we now go back to ask, do we see this particular very strange mutational signature in cancers? We collaborated with a very large repository in Amsterdam from the Hartwig Center. 8,000 metastatic cancers, fully whole genome sequenced. We asked, is there anywhere in this is in this biobank do we see the PKS signature? And indeed, we see it. We see about 10 to 20% of the cases of this particular cancer. Lo and behold, it's colon cancer. We get an occasional hit in head and neck cancers. We have a few more now. That's also a site where E. coli can live. And we get the occasional hit in the urinary tract cancers. We also have a few more now. And so this is now guilt by association, but we think it's strong proof that, or a strong suggestion that indeed these bacteria that many of us carry in our colons cause mutations. Here you see the mutations actually in colon. These are probably called by PKS E. coli. These are random mutations in the genome, so can they also generate oncogenic mutations? That is indeed what we find. A significant number of the oncogenic mutations in these colon cancer cases is caused by the mechanism that I just described. And here you see, for instance, the knockout of APC mutant in about 90% of all colon cancers, easily done by colibactin in a patient. So this is in a real cancer. And another one here, mismatch repair deficient gene, MSH3, is easily knocked out by the colibactin. So when, if you have to draw if you want to draw conclusions from this, we're currently actually in several very large national studies in Holland, but also in England, for instance, trying to confirm that this signature is indeed indicative of the presence of the bacterium. Next step would be that you somehow get rid of E. coli PKS and replace it by a normal E. coli, and there are various ways of doing this. Finally, Corona, when we went into lockdown in March, my institute only allowed experiments on Corona. So we sat down and we came up with the following plan. 15th of March, we realized that ACE2 was published as the receptor of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. We also knew that ACE2 has an extremely high expression in the human gut, much higher than anywhere else, including the lungs of humans. We also started seeing the first clinical reports that COVID-19 patients, 20 to 30% of the patients, present with gastrointestinal problems rather than with respiratory problems. And there were some indications, some reports that you could see viral RNA in the feces of infected patients, implying that it does not only affect the lungs, but it can affect other organs and maybe replicate there and maybe be transmitted through that route. And indeed, when we grew the virus together with our human intestinal organoids, in white we stain for the nuclear protein of the virus, it readily infects. And when we wait longer than one day, so 60 hours, you can see that the virus spreads throughout the organoid. And we did a lot of RNA-seq and single-cell-seq, et cetera, but this is the fastest paper that we ever published, from the idea to having it online in Science with two rounds of serious review, was actually from 15th of March to the 1st of May. I don't think that we'll ever be able to do that again. And it was actually simultaneously published by two other labs. And since then, this is quite a popular paper, but also quite a popular technology, rather than using the fibroblasts or the cell lines that are used by virologists, like Vero cells that really do not reflect epithelia. Organoids are becoming exceedingly popular, and I'll show you in the last bit of my talk why that is. So here again, I show that you can infect duodenal organoids quite well. In airway organoids, we can do CRISPR, but it's very slow. So we actually we are making the mutations I'll talk now about in airway organoids, but this is done in gut organoids. We knocked out two of the key genes, host genes that were known to be important, ACE2, the receptor for SARS-CoV-2. This is the wild type. This is the ACE2 mutant. It doesn't get infected. TMPRSS2 is another surface protease that that actually proteolytically activates the spike protein and then induces fusion of the virus with the host cell membrane. If we knock that out, essentially we lose infectivity, implying that these two are essential genes, essential host genes. So we then when this worked, we actually looked a little bit further. So again, you see that SARS-CoV-2 works well with wild-type organoids, but doesn't work with ACE2 mutant clones from several different donors. We showed two here. MERS is also a deadly coronavirus, much more deadly than SARS-CoV-2, uses a different receptor, DPP-4, and indeed it's not affected by the ACE2 mutations. SARS, the original SARS virus uses the same ACE2, and indeed its production is totally lost when you knock out ACE2. You can see how that works here. For MERS, it's the other way around. Now we knock out DPP-4. These are all confirmatory experiments. SARS-CoV-2 can still infect DPP-4 mutant cell lines, despite the fact that at least one paper published that this was also a receptor for SARS-CoV-2. The cells really don't care about this, but they can no longer be infected by MERS. So you get the opposite phenotype, and you see the data here. This is actually the number of infectious particles. This is just staining for the virus. We then went through a number of proteases that have come out of whole genome CRISPR screens. Particularly, I'll mention here cathepsin L that has come out of the three cell papers in a row that claim that cathepsin L is key for infection of the virus. This is done in not in epithelial cells, but it's done in Vero cells or in A456 cells. When we knock out cathepsin L, if anything, we get more infectious particles produced. And if we knock out any of the TMPRSS2 genes, only or the TMPRSS genes, so that's the one that would mediate fusion, only TMPRSS2 affects production of virus relative to the wild type levels. So we do not see that cathepsin L plays any role in primary epithelia. Of note, cathepsin L is a endocytosis pathway protease. TMPRSS2 is a surface membrane protease. So they do very different things. There's a list of other genes that have been published in high-flying journals. We knocked them out, like neuropilin recently, two science papers. We see no effect. So the only two genes that we see are key are ACE2 and TMPRSS2. I'm almost done here. Finally, of course, you know the chloroquine story. Chloroquine, no, fantastic in cell line screens, does nothing in patients. A lot of chaos around the world over this compound. We repeated the experiment on Vero cells with chloroquine. As you can see, it can completely block entry of the virus and production of virus particles at 10 micromolar concentration. At 1 micromolar concentration is about the IC50. If we use chloroquine at 10 micromolar, you see that here, the blue line, there is no effect whatsoever on viral production. We can block viral production with an inhibitor, a broad inhibitor that would hit TMPRSS2 here. We cannot hit the virus with a broad, not very specific kinase protease inhibitor that would block cathepsin L. So this implies that actually the way by which, and I think I summarized it here, yeah. So the way by which the virus enters these workhorse cell lines that virologists use a lot, like VeroA6, is through endocytosis. So the virus binds to ACE2. It's then taken up by endocytosis. Cathepsin L then essentially releases the virus. This is my last slide. This is not happening in primary epithelia. In primary epithelia, the process is very different. A surface protease, TMPRSS2, activates spike. It then induces fusion, and the RNA and the genome of the virus released into the cell. So had the virologists used organoids instead of these workhorse cell lines, they would never have written papers that chloroquine might be a useful drug for treating SARS-CoV-2. And with that, I think I named the people that were involved in these studies. And I'd like to thank you very much for your attention. And if there's any time and interest, I can answer a few questions. Thank you.
Well, this was absolutely overwhelming. And I'm wondering how many people are working together with you to get this huge amount of brilliant work done in such a short time period.
So my lab is usually around 40 people, so it's a big lab, mostly postdocs, and they're very independent. So I don't have a sort of a second in command or so. So it's a very organic, and I think the strength has always been that everybody collaborates with everybody. Okay. People train each other, and they have full freedom. The E. coli story, which I find spectacular, was actually, I didn't even know they were doing this up until they had the results.
This is really brilliant. So there is one question from Christian Gillison. what were the tissues labeled as NA that also showed a similar mutational signature as PKS?
Oh yeah, so that's a good question. NA means not annotated. So we think they're colon cancers, but it's very difficult. So there was a metastasis where they didn't really know what the primary was. When we look at the mutations, they look like colon cancers. They have Wnt pathway mutations, but formally they are in the NA classification. What I didn't say is actually, this study was repeated in a very large UK cohort. This was actually published, if somebody wants to read it up, in Nature recently. Mm-hmm. And there, the exact same findings were made, depending on where you put the threshold, 10 to 15% of colon cancer patients have this signature, again, implying, and others don't, or very rarely have this, implying that's really the microbiome that does this, and very likely it's the PKS E. coli that's responsible.
Okay, I have a question regarding the CRISPR-Cas method. It seems to work quite well in your hands, and you can convert mutant organoids or stem cells into wild type ones. And this is what we all want to have for gene therapy. So what are the next steps for you to get it really into clinical practice?
Yeah, well, so if you would want, so I think to do this in vivo would be exceedingly difficult, because you would have to be able to transfect the majority of the target cells in the tissue that you want to modify. And then also in the cells that you transfect, you have to be extremely efficient in hitting the right things and not doing the wrong things or doing nothing at all. So my idea would be that you could easily use this. So it's very easy out. So you can actually take a biopsy outside the body, grow it up. We did this 7 years already in the more tedious homologous recombination approach. And then, so the next step to give it back. The big two hurdles are, first of all, you have to be allowed to and be able to transplant organoids. Now there is a trial, our collaborators who've done this in Japan, where the regulatory conditions are very different, much more in line with developing stem cell therapies. They actually were starting a first-in-man trial transplanting organoids back to patients with inflammatory bowel disease, autologous organoids. That was halted because of Corona, and I don't think the clinic has yet allowed them to open up again. Very labor-intensive. But if that would work, the next step would then be, now you modify genetically. That's another layer of complexity for the regulatory authorities. So okay. I think in the lab, we can do this. We've done it in mice extensively, works very well. But I don't think my lab is, this should probably be done in an industrial setting with you know, a lot of capital behind it. I don't think it's the role of my lab to make this clinically applicable.
I see. There's another CRISPR question from Malte Spielmann. Can you comment on the use of base editors versus primer editing? What would you put your money on?
Yeah, so I was very lucky to have a starting PhD student who was in Boston with George Church, or with, what's her name, Liu. And so he knew both techniques before they were published. He introduced them in our lab in a good collaboration. So what we see is the base editors are fantastic. He has a paper very recently from my lab on correcting cystic fibrosis stop codons with base editors. Mm-hmm. Whole genome sequence, the only thing we see is in the small bubble where that Cas9 creates, because essentially Cas9 is disabled. It cannot cut the DNA, but it calls the bubble. And then the base editor enzyme will then edit the base in that small bubble. If you happen to have two Cs, it might edit both. Mm-hmm. So if you have only one, it's always good. We get a lot of homozygous corrections. It's extremely efficient and safe. Prime editing, we've also done, much more tedious. You have to actually design multiple to find an approach to introduce a particular mutation. The advantage of prime editing, you can in essence make any mutation. With base editors at the moment, it's about 1 in 3 of the base changes you can make. And because it's C's to T's, and C's is the most common base to be mutated. When we look at mutations as they occur in humans, it's close to half of the mutations we can correct with the existing base editors. If the base editors can do what you want, they are much, much better than anything else. If not, I think we could move to prime editing.
Okay, I allow for a final question, and this is by Uwe Kornack. He asked, have you looked in microbiome data for the frequency of the cancer-causing E. coli?
Yeah, that's also a good question. So this would be looking for the PKS, pathogenicity island, this particular piece of extra DNA with the 10 enzymes. There are quite a few studies that do this in different patient groups. So there is associative evidence that it's more common in colon cancer. It is more common in familial adenomatous polyposis patients. It's more common in inflammatory bowel disease patients. But we are now, Holland has a national screening program for colon cancer, where we send feces to a central facility and they measure human hemoglobin, but the same samples can be tested for PKS. So we're actually now, we just started a huge study where we try to find who has these bacteria. Is it in a family? Is it kids? Do they lose them? Is it particular patients? And how strong is the association with colon cancer? There's also a big study in Canada starting and in England as well, because it would be like Helicobacter, if you can find it, prove that it causes cancer and then get rid of it, you would probably get rid of quite a few colon cancer cases.
Yeah. So for the sake of time, I'm afraid we have to move on now, although there is a further question.